Thanks for joining us today, and welcome. I'd like to take a quick break from covering forgotten events and places in U.S. history and cover the history that's unfolding right in front of our eyes. And of course, I'm talking about the novel coronavirus or COVID-19. However, before I do, let's take a look around my town and see how we're holding up. Governments around the world implement travel bans, and different cities and states are putting in varying degrees of lockdowns, and people begin to practice social distancing, we're noticing that our cities are beginning to look like the ghost towns I more commonly frequent. Many Americans, and for that matter, people worldwide, are getting to feel the experience I get as they walk through a town and that eerie feeling of complete abandonment. However, they're doing it as they go to the bank, the grocery store, or pharmacy, because in many cities and states, that's the only places you're allowed to leave the house for. So, what is all the hubbub about? Why is this so very, very serious? Well, let's look into our past to try to get an understanding of our future. To paraphrase the Greek god Janus, the man who looks to the past and the future is blind in one eye, but the man who looks to only the future is blind in both eyes. Despite popular belief, we have not seen a major pandemic in living memory. There have, however, been major yet localized epidemics such as SARS or MERS, both of which were more deadly than COVID-19 has been thus far. And let's not forget Ebola, which during its epidemic killed a little over 11,300 people and is still a problem in some areas of the world to this day. This is a little confusing when you consider that COVID-19 has killed a little over 13,000 people to date. And this goes back to the difference between a pandemic and an epidemic. An epidemic is defined as an outbreak or a disease that spreads quickly and affects many individuals at the same time. As a pandemic is a type of epidemic, but it has a greater range and coverage. So in other words, it's larger, it's global, and it has a bigger reach. It's not as localized. So this is why everything we know from living history is actually an epidemic. To find the last pandemic, we have to go back to January 1918, when the Spanish flu was reported by the Spanish army. However, it had been circulating in the European armies for over a year before it was noted and reported in a British army hospital in that January. Some say it started in China and was mutated on a U.S. military base in Kansas, and then eventually made its way to the front line. Regardless of how it started, it made its way around the world, because the world was in the midst of World War I. And we had little knowledge of viruses and diseases and how they spread. Furthermore, the news of the Spanish flu was suppressed by the French, US, British, and German governments, as they feared it would impact the troops' morale and make them appear weak. This information suppression was instrumental in spreading the disease early on. Later, in 1918, the soldiers returned home and brought with them a very virulent version of the virus. Just like COVID-19, the world population had no immunity or tolerance for the virus built up in their systems. This is the key difference between the common flu and the Spanish flu. Even to this day, the common flu kills about 650,000 people worldwide. However, this is a known variable, meaning we can account for what it will do, when it will do it, and where it will do it. Whereas with novel viruses, we have no history to go off of and don't know what to expect. In other words, it's an unknown variable. Spanish flu went on to become the second largest health crisis, second only to the bubonic plague of the Middle Ages. It managed to spread to every continent and infect upwards of 30% of the world population, of 1.8 billion at that time. Before the flu pandemic was through, it had claimed over 50 million lives. And record keeping wasn't exactly accurate, that's plus or minus a few. This is a solemn reminder of what can happen if we don't get ahead of a pandemic and it gets out of control. Similar to the Spanish flu, it's the less fortunate who will be most impacted. However, this is going to impact everyone to some degree. We now know the Spanish flu was an outbreak of the H1N1 virus, a breed of virus that's common in birds and pigs, which is why it's often referred to as bird flu or swine flu. Similar to COVID-19, it jumped from one species to the next, from close contact with infected animals that got within the food chain. Even though the Spanish flu is an influenza virus and COVID-19 is a coronavirus, they both attack the lung. Those who have survived the worst cases of COVID-19 are often left with scarring on their lungs and a reduced lung capacity. A report from the Chinese Center for Disease Control found the mortality rate of COVID-19 to be 2.3%. The Spanish flu killed its hosts at a rate of 2.5%. To give you a frame of reference, the common flu kills at a rate of 0.1%, meaning the Spanish flu was 25 times more lethal and COVID-19 was 23 times more lethal than the common flu. Now, what's important is to not panic. We're gonna be okay, and we're gonna be better than ever after this. Just because the data is similar to the Spanish flu, this doesn't mean the outcome will be similar. The differences between 1918 medicine and today are too numerous to count, and epidemiologists have been learning a lot from our past. However, it's time for us to focus our attention on the present and write history together. Let's change how deadly COVID-19 is to the world. It starts with social distancing and better sanitization habits, yes. And no, hoarding toilet paper is not the answer. You know who you are. No, but seriously, thank you so much to the medical staff, first responders, and social distance superstars. For the most up-to-date information on COVID-19, please visit the link below this video, and stay safe, everyone.